2,000 years ago, a series of events happened that changed mankind forever. We're here to celebrate those events through the life of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're glad you've chosen to join us because you're about to witness and experience firsthand the journey that Jesus traveled. We encourage you to think about the sacrifice he makes and how it's changed lives for those same 2,000 years. As you watch, remember this. If you'd have been the only person ever born, Jesus still would have made this journey just for you. We know it is God who gave Jesus to us and for us from the scriptures, many places. Very famous and well-known one, Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse 16, John 3:16. Many of you know it, say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus, that spotless Lamb of God given to die so that we might live. Let's go back to that little town in Bethlehem where the story starts. Let's follow Jesus through his life, his death, and his glorious resurrection. But you know what? You can't just take my word for it. Come, and you will see that he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Thank you. how well I remember when my life was changed forever. I'll never forget the angel and the wise men and the shepherd. It was the Lord and creator of all the universe who had stepped down off of his glorious throne in heaven to be born and laid in a manger. And they had all come to worship him. As I look back over the years, I can't believe how quickly time has passed. My son, Jesus, grew and did the things that most boys do. He spent time with his earthly father, Joseph, learning the trade of a carpenter. And as he grew older, he began to spend time in the temple, learning the ways of his heavenly father. Our family and friends were amazed at how quickly Jesus learned and how wise he was, even at such a very young age. I'll always love and cherish the time that Jesus and I spent together, but all too soon, the years have passed. And Jesus is now 30 years old, and it's time for him to leave home and to begin his ministry. But first, he wanted to seek out his cousin John to be baptized. John, who was known throughout all the area as John the Baptist, was preaching and teaching and baptizing in the Jordan River. And it was here that Jesus was first publicly recognized by John and proclaimed to be the one and only Lamb of God.
And so I say to you, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Who are you?
I am a voice crying in the wilderness. Repent!
Are you Elijah?
I am not.
Are you a prophet?
No. I have come to make straight the way of the Lord.
Then tell us who you are, so we can go back and tell those who sent us.
I am not the Messiah. There is one who comes after me, who is mightier than I, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to stoop down and loosen. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus, I should come to you to be baptized. Why is it then that you come to me?
John, it should be done, for we must carry out all that God requires.
This is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased.
Many did believe that Jesus was the promised Messiah who had come to save the world. But there were also the doubters. They knew they could not allow this man, the son of a carpenter, to be known as the great Messiah. Ah, yes, many were now following Jesus and watching him very closely, but none more than Satan. After Jesus was baptized, he went into the wilderness to fast and to pray. And it was here that Satan appeared to Jesus and confronted him in an attempt to stop God's miraculous plan for all mankind.
So you must be this Jesus I've heard so much about. Some say you're the Son of God. Is it true? Are you the Son of God? Because if you were, this wilderness is the last place I'd expect to find you starving to death. And if you were the Son of God, you could turn any of these stones into bread and feed yourself. Show me your power.
I have been out in this wilderness for 40 days. I am tired and weak, and yes, I am hungry. However, my Heavenly Father, He will supply all my needs. And it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God.
Walk with me. I'd like to show you something. Have you considered this temple and how you could use it for your glory? You could climb to its top, throw yourself down, for it is written, He will command His angels concerning you. Why, you wouldn't even strike your foot on a stone. Prove to me who you are.
It is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Lucifer, I seek to do the will of my Heavenly Father only.
Jesus, behold, all the kingdoms and the wealth of the world given to me to do with as I please. And I would give it all to you. Just come, bow at my feet, give me the worship I deserve.
I will not bow to you. You are to worship the Lord your God and serve Him only. You are a deceiver and the father of lies. Get away from me, Satan. I will worship only you, my Father.
When Jesus left the wilderness, God told him to gather men around him that he could teach and prepare to carry on his work. As Jesus turned to 12 very ordinary, common men, he called each of them by name. They gave up everything that they had to follow Jesus and become his disciples. They left the only occupations they had ever known. They also left behind their families and their friends, giving up all their possessions as well as all the comforts of home. These 12 men from very different walks of life said yes to the radical commitment that Jesus was calling them to, a commitment that would change their lives forever.
Andrew,
Peter, come, follow me.
Sometimes I know people wonder how we could leave all we've known, throw down our nets in a moment, and turn from our jobs and our homes.
His call to us from the seashore, as deep as the call of the sea, threw us into His adventure and gave us the courage to leave. We followed the man. We followed His voice. Hearing Him call to our hearts, we rushed to the shore. We never no regret. We turn from a life built on sand, and we followed the man. Not knowing where we were going, charting the waters of faith, led by His light through the darkness, drawn by the star of His grace, leaving our fears behind us, moving through restless seas, taking Him as our captain, not knowing where He would lead. follow the Lamb. We follow His voice. Hearing Him call to our hearts, we rush to the shore. We never look back. We have no regret. We turn from a life to confess, and we follow the man.
We had no map to lead us. We had no kind of plan. When He called, we followed, though we did not understand.
We followed the man. We followed His voice. Hearing Him call to our hearts, we rushed to the shore. We never looked back. We turn from the light built on sand, and we follow the man. We follow the man. We follow the man.
After Jesus called us to be His disciples, we traveled with Him through Galilee and the surrounding areas. We were with Him as He taught the people the glorious kingdom of God. We witnessed as He changed the lives of the people that He encountered. When the word about Jesus traveled around and people heard about that, they would come by the hundreds. Yes, even by the thousands, traveling at times for days, just to be near Him. They wanted to hear His message of love, of sacrifice, of forgiveness. They haven't heard rabbis preach like that before. Often the crowds were so large that Jesus would stand on the mountainside or maybe get into a boat and sail out into the water. Everyone then could see and hear Him. They wanted to hear the authoritative voice of Jesus. Again, His love and His forgiveness. You know, here comes Jesus now. Come with me. Let's see Jesus.
Bless you, my child. Bless you.
Rabbi, so many have come. They hunger for your word.
Blessed are those that hunger and thirst for righteousness, just like you, Andrew. They will be filled.
Jesus, what do we need to do to enter the kingdom?
Blessed are the peacemakers. The peacemakers are those that use their powers of influence to help resolve hostilities within families and with neighbors. The peacemakers shall be called the sons and the daughters of God, your Father in heaven. Also blessed are the persecuted, not because of any crimes they may have done, but persecuted because of their faith and belief in me, that I am the true and only Son of God. For the persecuted, their reward one day will be the glorious kingdom of heaven. You've heard it said before, to love your neighbors and to hate your enemies. Oh, but dear brothers and sisters, I want you to love your enemies. Yes, love them. If you only love those that already love you, where is the reward in that? For those that harass you, that conspire against you, that spread rumors about you, that are mean to you for no reason, I want you to pray for them. I want you to show them love and mercy and kindness and compassion, and most of all, forgiveness, just as my Father and I have shown to you. So one day, you may be considered the sons, and yes, the precious daughters of God, your Father in heaven.
Love your enemies? Did he say love your enemies? I've never heard that before. Such strange teachings from the rabbi.
But Master, we've been here all day with no food or water. We're so hungry.
Dear brother, I hear you and I do understand your concerns. But I say to you, dear brother, and to everyone else, do not worry about what you'll eat or drink. But instead, I want you to consider the birds of the air. You see, these wonderful little creations of God, they do not sow or reap. They don't even store away in barns. And yet, your heavenly Father, he feeds them. I ask you, as God's greatest creation, are you not much more valuable than they? And why do you worry about your clothes? Why do you worry so about what you're going to wear? Come here, little one. I think I need to ask you a question. Now, when you wake up in the morning, you don't worry about what you're going to wear, do you? Of course not. As I look around, I still see some puzzled faces. Some of you aren't quite sure. But this will make it all clear. May I? Thank you. It's beautiful. You see this beautiful flower? If this is how God clothes the grass that we walk on, with beautiful flowers that he created that are here today and gone tomorrow, I ask you, will he not much more clothe you? Can all of your worries add one single moment to your life? No. So I say to you, don't worry about what you'll eat or drink, about what you'll wear. Don't worry about such material things, but seek ye first the glorious kingdom of God. John, Peter, it's okay. Please, let the little children come to me. Surely the kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Please, let all the little children come, and let's make room for them.
Thank you. By this time in Jesus' ministry, many had come to trust in him as their all in all, and yet there were still those who doubted him. Everywhere Jesus went, there were people in need. Some needed healing from sickness and disease. Others needed a release from an internal struggle that enslaved and oppressed them. Many came just simply to touch him, to feel the love that he and he alone could give. The reason for coming didn't really matter. When you were in the presence of Jesus, you knew that something special, something supernatural was about to happen. Perhaps you are like these who have come, and you need that special something that only Jesus can give. Jesus has arrived. There is anticipation in the air. Come with me and see the miracles that only Jesus can give to those who come to him.
Who touched me? Who touched me?
Master, the crowd is pressing in from all around. It could have been anyone.
Someone touched me, Peter, I know, because I felt the power leave from my body.
Rabbi, it was I. Please. Please forgive me. Jesus, I've been ill for 12 years now. No physician's been able to heal me, and I knew that if I could just touch you, I'd be healed. And the moment that I touched the hem of your garment, I was made whole again.
Oh, my precious daughter, it was your faith that healed you. Rise and go in peace.
That's because my faith is in you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Did you see? I just touched the hem of his garment and the blood stopped.
Jesus, something special, supernatural about.
Proclaim with worthy praise that matchless name. Oh. God you just witnessed, the miracles that Jesus performed, and the love that he gave caused more and more people to follow him. Right now, everyone is coming together for one of the most holy and festive times of the year. This is the season of Passover. People are gathering to pray, to make sacrifices in the temple, and to celebrate God's deliverance of the Jewish people from bondage in Egypt. In the holy city of Jerusalem, the air is filled with excitement and wonder. A joyful celebration is in progress. As Jesus enters the massive city gates, a cheering crowd welcomes him. Children are singing, and everyone is waving palm branches as if welcoming a new king. The crowd rejoices with shouts of praise, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord."
All glory, Lord, and honor,
Hosanna, Hosanna,
to you, Redeemer King,
Hosanna,
the praises of your children,
Hosanna, Hosanna,
their loud hosannas ring,
Hosanna,
the mighty King of Israel, the royal holy Son. We lift our voice and sing, rejoice our King.
Popularity continued to grow among the common people, and this angered the priests and the Pharisees. They felt threatened by Jesus because he challenged the power that they had over the people. The Jewish leaders were so desperate to get rid of Jesus that they used greed, the love of money, to convince one of Jesus' own disciples to betray him. For just 30 pieces of silver, their trap was set. Jesus knew that time for the Pharisees' plan was drawing near, and he wanted to share his last hours with his beloved disciples, celebrating the traditional Jewish Passover. For the past 3 years, these men had listened to Jesus' teachings, witnessed his miracles, and learned how to demonstrate acts of love and of kindness. As Jesus greeted his disciples, he knew he must give them one last act by which to remember him by. As the ultimate Passover lamb, Jesus would offer his very body and blood as he passed the bread and the cup. He would tell of things to come, acts of betrayal and denial. And then Jesus bowed down as a humble servant to wash their feet. This was their Lord, their master, bowing in an act of servitude before them. Jesus deserved praise and worship, and what the disciples were witnessing confused them. But Jesus continued teaching them that this act was done as an example for them to serve others, just like he had served them. Before the night was over, these men who had witnessed the love, the power, and the grace of Jesus firsthand would have to rely on these things more than they ever had.
My dear brothers, we've been together a long time. We have seen and done many things together. We've laughed together, we've cried together, and we have worshiped together. But tonight, all of that will change. Tonight, one of you at this table will betray me.
Master, even if I have to die, I will not betray you.
Peter, I tell you the truth. Before the rooster crows, you, Peter, you will have denied me three times.
Master, is it I?
It is as you say, Judas. Go quickly and do what you must.
You who are humble, you who are gentle, breathtaking beauty, life-giving touch. We who are empty, we who are hungry, frail and unworthy, needing so much. But you've called us worthy and able to meet with you at your table. Here where you serve us, here where you feed us, our time with you is the sweetest.
Worthy of the praise, our Savior.
serving men
here at your table.
After we'd finished eating, Jesus had very little to say as he led us into a garden area called Gethsemane. The agony on his face was so real, it frightened us. And while we did not fully understand, his mood told us something terrible was about to happen. Once in the garden, he instructed all of us to watch and pray. Then he took three of us further into the garden with him. As he spoke, we could sense the anguish in his voice. Then Jesus went further into the garden alone, and it was there that he prayed to his Father in heaven as he agonized over what he knew was about to happen.
My soul. It is overwhelmed, even to the point of death. I need you to stay here and keep watch for me. You must watch and pray. Watch and pray. My Father, may this hour pass away from me, for my soul, it is in anguish. Is there no other way? Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. No, not what I will, Father, but only what you will. Peter, could you not keep watch with me for 1 hour? You must watch and pray so you don't fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak. Watch and pray. Pray. You're still sleeping? Look, the hour is near. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, all of you up! Look, here comes my betrayer.
I've seen him do magic. He can say, rise up! He can rise up! this way!
We're gonna be next. We're gonna think. We gotta think what we're gonna do.
You were with Jesus of Nazareth.
No. I was not with him. No.
Aren't you one of Jesus' disciples?
I am not one of them. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know this. But we've got to get together, and we've got to decide what we're going to do.
We don't know.
But we can't let John. Go.
This man was with him. His speech is that of a Galilean.
I don't know what you're talking about. I am not one of them. I don't know the man. I don't know him.
Oh, no, Lord, Master, what did I do?
The words Jesus spoke at the table were now coming true. One of them has betrayed Jesus, and one of them has denied him 3 times before the rooster crowed. Jesus is now in the hands of the religious leaders. The disciples watched in fear as Jesus was led away. They couldn't understand why this was happening. They believed Jesus was the Messiah, the Son of God. Why didn't he put up a fight? They knew he could have called the angels. They would have rescued him. They knew he had the power to set himself free. But instead, he let them lead him away as if he were a common criminal. Like a lamb being led to slaughter. And so the disciples just ran off into the night. The fear and the anguish the disciples experienced at that moment, however, was nothing compared to what Jesus was about to suffer and endure.
The Jewish leaders had made many attempts to discredit Jesus and his teachings among the people, but all their efforts had failed. It was their growing hatred that led them to create a plan that would bring about the final destruction of Jesus. After Jesus was arrested, he was brought before Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had gathered. During the night, Jesus endured false accusations and beatings. They blindfolded him. They pulled his beard. They spit on him, and they mocked him. Yet, Jesus never retaliated, and he never fought back. And he never denied that he was the Son of God. As dawn was approaching, the Jewish leaders had to be ready with their charges they would bring against Jesus. Charges of subverting a nation, blaspheming God, and claiming to be a king. With these charges, they would be able to bring Jesus before Pontius Pilate, the highest ranking Roman official in the area. Now, it was a custom of Pilate's to release a prisoner back to the people during the Passover feast. The Jewish leaders had to ensure this would not be Jesus, even if it meant releasing a murderer and an insurrectionist like Barabbas. It was before Pilate that the Jewish leaders would finally get what they wanted, the death of Jesus.
Bring Jesus before the assembly.
Ha 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 ha!
Look at him.
Don't look like much of a king to me. Pick him up. Pick him up.
Come on.
Take the blindfold off.
What say you of this man Jesus?
We heard him say, I will destroy this man-made temple, and within 3 days we'll build another not made by hand.
Pick him up. What say you to these testimony given against you? You have nothing to say? I charge you under an oath of the living God. Are you the Christ, the Son of the living God?
It is, as you say.
Blasphemy!
That's why do we need any more testimony? We've heard it from his own lips. What say you?
Take him to Pilate!
And the whole assembly arose and led Jesus to Pilate. And the Jewish leaders began inciting the crowd, yelling for the death of Jesus. Centuries of prophecy had now come down to 3 years. 3 years had now come down to 3 days. This is how the first day began. One balcony, one man, and a tempestuous crowd.
Or Jesus, who is called Christ.
Piper.
What would you have me to do with the King of the Jews?
My hands are clean of the blood of this just man. That responsibility is on you. Free Barabbas. Scourge and crucify Jesus.
It appeared that the Jewish leaders had won. They had gotten what they wanted, a death sentence for Jesus. Now they would be rid of him forever. But what a sad day for the people of Jerusalem. Remember, they were here to celebrate the Passover. This season intended to be a time of celebration and thanksgiving for what God had done for the Jewish people had now become a time of suffering and torture. Jesus, condemned, was about to be mocked and beaten by the Roman soldiers. A rope of thorns would be pressed into his brow as his crown, and a blood-stained robe would be put around his shoulders as his royal garment. Jesus was about to be so badly beaten that he would be unrecognizable, and yet his journey would still not be over.
Jesus?
Come on, Jesus. Come on. Where's your disciples?
Save us all your people. Take yourself down. Come on, Jesus.
Yes, this is God's Son, God's only Son, Jesus. Through Him, God's love reached all the way through history, to you and to me. For God's Word taught us the penalty for our sin is death. But Jesus taught God made a way for our sins to be forgiven. God gave His only begotten Son to be the sacrifice for our sins. Now Jesus, the ultimate sacrifice, is making His final earthly journey, a lamb led to the slaughter. But from now on, no more sacrifices will need to be made to pay the penalty of sin. All we have to do is believe and trust in Jesus. In making the journey to the cross, Jesus paved a way for us to be free. Free from the sin that holds us hostage. Free from the possibility of life without God. Free to live an abundant and eternal life. Why would Jesus do this? Why would God allow His only Son to die such a horrible death? Because He loves us. God did not want us to make the journey up that hill, so He sent Jesus to walk that road for us, to carry that cross for us, and to die on that cross for us.
Thank you. the world of sorrows. He bore the weight of all my tears. He took my anguish on his back and shouldered every fear. The love that drove him onward would pave the way with every crimson stone. He walked the road of sorrows as he bore my cross with every dying breath. The blood that stained the pathway has paid the price for all my sin and shame. He walked the road of sorrows with the cross that bears my name. How could I know the mystery of grace? How love could hold him there, dying in my place? And every time I see those labored footsteps, all his suffering, I know in everything. He walked the road of sorrows. He bore my cross to Calvary. He walked the road of sorrows, and he walked that road for me.
If you are the Christ, save yourself and us.
Stand up here, God! Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Assuredly, I say to you, because of your faith in me, today you will be in paradise.
This is your paradise, Jesus.
Arthur!
Your son is dead!
and everyone in it belonged to me.
Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Surely he took up our pains and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed.
His heart was broken, mine was mended. He became sick, now I am clean. The cross he carried bore my burden. The nails that held him set me free. His life for mine, his life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die for son to die to save? Of suffering brought me healing. He shed his blood to fill my soul. His crown of thorns made me royalty. His sorrow gave me joy. Oh!
Jesus' followers were asking, how could this be? He was so kind and compassionate. He healed so many and did such great things. Who would have thought it would end this way? The lifeless body of Jesus was taken from the cross and wrapped in fresh linen. Several of Jesus' followers carried his body and laid him in a new but borrowed tomb with a large rock moved to seal the entrance. A day that had begun with a crowd screaming for an execution would finally end at a silent grave. The next day, the Sabbath, dawned gray and helpless. Can you imagine the hopelessness of that Saturday? How can you fathom the despair of a faith that has just died? Jesus' followers were either immobilized by grief or hiding in fear. The tomb was secured and guards remained to make sure that the disciples could not move the body. And on the second day, death appeared to have claimed the final victory. It was now the third day. Early Sunday morning, several women who had followed Jesus during his ministry gathered spices to take and anoint his body. Mary, the mother of Jesus, was a part of this group. Imagine the pain she must have felt as she walked that road to her son's grave. As the women approached the tomb where Jesus was buried, they noticed that the massive stone that had sealed the entrance had been rolled away. The guards were gone. How could this be? The women began to fear the worst. Maybe someone had stolen his body. But as dawn was breaking, they realized that once again, Almighty God was at work.
Do not be alarmed. You come here seeking Jesus, who was crucified and buried. But he is not here. He is risen.
The gates and doors were barred, and all the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness, arose at every sound, half in hopeless sorrow and half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. Just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. There was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. John stood there beside her as she told us where she'd been. She said they moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. We both ran toward the garden, then John ran on ahead. We found the stone and the empty tomb, just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Well, something strange had happened there, but just what I didn't know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, 'cause I'd seen them crucify him, then I saw him die. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. And even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. Then suddenly the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide, and I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. But then he raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt and my confusion disappeared in sweet release. Everything I'd ever said just melted into peace.
No, can't be you. I saw you crucified. I saw you buried. No, no, it can't be you. It can't be you. No, no.
He's alive.
As for Peter and the rest of the disciples, this changes everything. Peter finally found the forgiveness he thought he would never find. The rest of the disciples, they now understand what they're supposed to be doing. They wasted no time telling the people. Jesus is alive, and he could change their lives forever. You see, none of this was chance. It was all part of God's plan. God's plan started when he created the world. It was finished with Jesus' death and resurrection. And he did it all because he loves you. He knows what you've done. He knows what's been done to you. He's asking you to bring it all. Lay it at his feet. Embrace him the way Peter embraced him. He's waiting on you. He wants to heal you. He wants to save you. Don't wait until you think you're good enough. Jesus said, come to me, and I will make you good enough.
Jesus spent nearly 40 days after his resurrection appearing to his disciples and many others of us. He wanted us to know that he really is alive, and that we need to go and tell the world about his love and his forgiveness.
All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. I want you to go to all nations and baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. I want you to teach them to observe the things that I have commanded you. And my dear brothers, remember, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age.
The disciples knew that they must heed Jesus' final words to them, spreading the good news that Jesus lives and all who come to believe and accept Jesus can be covered by his mercy of forgiveness. The disciples knew that Jesus holds our lives and eternal future in his hands. As they gathered with many who had come to believe and brought others to hear the good news, they watched as Jesus went up into heaven. With his birth, ministry, death, burial, resurrection, and ascension into heaven, Jesus fulfilled what the scriptures had foretold about him. And while looking up into the sky, straining our eyes to see him, an angel appeared and spoke to us.
People, why do you stand there staring into the skies? Don't you know that this Jesus who was taken away from you into heaven will one day return to you in the same manner from heaven?
Well, aren't you thankful that one of these days soon he's coming back? He's coming back. And you know why Jesus went to the cross? And this is the good news. This is the best news anybody's ever heard. He went to the cross to to pay for our sin so that we could be forgiven and we could spend eternity with him in heaven. And you know, God loves you so much that if you had been the only person to have ever be born, that Jesus would have come to die on that cross just for you. That's how much he loves you. And so what are we to do? Well, the Bible says if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, that we will be saved. That means that our sin will be forgiven and that we'll be given eternal life with the Lord in heaven. So before we leave tonight, I want to ask you this question. Has there been a time in your life when you've asked God to forgive your sin? And when you've invited Jesus Christ into your life to be your Savior? You say, is that all it takes? That's all it takes, but it cost God everything he had. It cost God his only son. So tonight before we go, we want to pray together. And maybe tonight you would like to pray and invite Christ into your life. So let's bow our heads and I'll lead us in a prayer, and you just pray this in your heart as I pray it out loud. And just pray it in childlike faith, believing, and you'll be asking Jesus to forgive you and to come and live in your life. Just say to him, Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and my sin has separated me from you. And I believe you are God's son. I believe you died on that cross for me. And I ask you to forgive my sin. And I invite you to come into my life and be my Savior. I place my faith in you. Lord, I can't understand it all intellectually. But I believe by faith. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus, and save me. And all the people of God said, Amen. Now, when you came in with your program, you got one of these cards. Would you get that card out for me just for a couple of seconds? We're not going to be long here, but just take a moment and just get this card out. And if you'll just hold it up, it's a registration card on one side. It's an invitation card on the other. Can you hold it up for me? Would you mind? Thank you. Now turn over to the back of it. And there's a box at the top that says, Tonight I prayed the prayer with the pastor to receive Christ as my Savior. If you prayed that prayer a moment ago to the Lord Jesus and you sincerely meant that in your heart, would you just check that box? And the reason we ask you to do that is just so we can rejoice with you that you've accepted Christ tonight, and we want to thank him for you and pray for you. And there are other boxes there that you might check that you're interested in. And if you have a prayer request, we'd love to pray for you. Just write your prayer request down there, and I promise you we'll pray for you. And there's a place to make comments if you would like to do that. But most of all, we're thankful to Jesus that tonight some of you were born into his family by faith. Amen? And now we've got one more scene for you. It's a little glimpse of what heaven is going to be like. So you enjoy. God bless.
The story of Jesus that you have just witnessed is not the ending. Oh no, these events were just the beginning. Jesus has taken his rightful place at the right hand of God the Father. Jesus, the great I am, loved us so much, he gave the greatest sacrifice of all, his life. Now, it takes more than just believing a story. It takes accepting Jesus to receive eternal life. The angels are gathered around the throne, watching as the redeemed are coming before the great Redeemer, the risen Savior, who shows grace and mercy to all who believed and accepted Jesus as Lord of their lives. Jesus, in His majesty, is Lord of all. It is through our faith in Him that we know He is alive and He reigns supremely. It is through Him that we, the redeemed, have eternal peace and joy. Jesus is the King of Kings. One day, all creation will come into the awesome presence of Jesus Christ. On that day, He will be high and exalted. His glory will shine like the sun. There will also come a time of judgment for all creation. For those who accepted Jesus, it will be contentment and joy with robes of righteousness and crowns of reward. For those who rejected Jesus, it will be sadness and sorrow with condemnation. All will give an account. All will bow before Jesus because God has exalted Him to the highest place and given Him the name above every name, Jesus. It is written, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is the one who was and is to come. He is holy and the giver of eternal life. He is King Jesus, the Savior of the world.
Temple and all of the air.